Yes, it is.
Okay, so it's 9 o'clock. Good evening, all viewers and students. This is the second series of lectures for pediatric postgraduate students that started off last week. Last week we had discussed the first six cranial nerves, and the topic for this time is examination of cranial nerves 7 to 12. And today's speaker is Dr. Prashant Jhawar, who needs no introduction, but just to say a few words, he's the assistant professor of the Child Neurology Division at All India Institute of Medical Sciences in New Delhi. So over to Prashant to start his deliberation.
Thank you, sir. So I'm sharing my screen. So without wasting time, let's start the talk. So the last week already, the first 4-6 cranial nerves were taken. So this talk will be about cranial nerve 7 to cranial nerve 12. So as I told you that my colleague, Dr. Bishrup, has taken the first 6 cranial nerves. So my job is to take the leftover 6 cranial nerves, that is from 7 to 12. So this is how I'll be talking about these nerves. First, I'll be discussing some part of the functional anatomy, give you certain core concepts, and then show you how to examine these cranial nerves and the interpretation of the key findings. So this is all to make the cranial nerve examination easy for everyone. So straight away, let us go to the 7th cranial nerve. Now, if I have to say that there is one cranial nerve which everyone, every physician should know about, is this nerve. So a little bit of the anatomy. So the 7th cranial nerve is actually a mixed nerve. So it originates from the pontine tegmentum. So if you can see, there is this red nucleus. The diagram on the left is the motor nuclei of the 7th cranial nerve, and the nerve originates from it, bends around the 6th cranial nerves and exits at the pontomedullary junction. So this motor nerve supplies the muscles of the face. So we know that the muscles of the face originate from the second branchial arc. So these fibers are actually known as the branchiomotor fibers. Along with these motor fibers, as it is a mixed nerve, there is another set of fibers. So there is one set of fibers which originate from the superior salivary nucleus, which is a parasympathetic nucleus. From here, the parasympathetic fibers then go meet the motor fibers and go along with the facial nerve and supply the tear glands and lacrimation and the salivation. Along with this, there are sensory fibers which originate from the nucleus tractus solitarius. So this nucleus is not exclusive for 7th nerve. The job of this nucleus is to supply the general and special visceral sensations to the head and neck. So in 7th nerve, this is supplying the sensory fibers with which the 7th nerve is carrying the taste sensation to the anterior 2/3 of the tongue. Along with these major three major fibers, there is a small twig which supplies sensations to the area around the ear. And this comes from the trigeminal sensory system. So this trigeminal sensory system is actually a very big nuclei. It has got the mesencephalic, pontine, and the spinal part. And this is responsible for all the general sensations of the head and neck. So whatever the nerve may be, if it is carrying a general sensation, it will have its origin from the trigeminal sensory system. And if it is carrying some visceral sensation, then it will originate from the nucleus tractus solitarius. So with this knowledge, let us go to this a bit complicated diagram, but I'll try to make it simple for you guys. So once the facial nerve leaves the brainstem, comes out into the subarachnoid space, it enters the internal auditory meatus along with the 8th nerve. And then takes a sharp bend at the geniculate ganglion, where the parasympathetic fibers leave the main nerve and through the greater superficial petrosal nerve, it supplies the glands of the eyes for lacrimation. The sensory and the motor fibers proceed further. After the bend, they give a small branch to the stapedius muscle, which is a small muscle of the middle ear. And then before entering into the facial canal, it gives the sensory fibers move out in the form of cauda tympani, and these supply the sublingual and the submandibular glands for salivation. The leftover motor fibers then descend through the facial canal and exit through the stylomastoid foramina, where they enter the parotid gland and give the terminal branches, which are 5 in number. The upper one is the temporal, next to it is the zygomatic, then it is the buccal branch, then comes the marginal mandibular branch, and then the cervical branch. So these would be supplying the muscles of facial expression. So there are no extra points for guessing the functions of facial nerve. So because the muscles are getting supplied, so it is involved in expressions of emotions. Because the facial orifice, the eyes, all are getting controlled by the facial nerve, so it is getting involved in the protection of these external facial apertures. As it supplies to the stapedius, it is working on dampening of loud sound. And then the sensory supply to the anterior two-thirds of the tongue, so it is covering the taste, and the parasympathetic supply actually covers for salivation, tearing, and snorting. So we all now know what a function of the facial nerve is. So we have to have some information about the supranuclear control of the facial nerve. So if you can see on this diagram, that this rectangle is representing pons. And these two red nuclei are the facial nerve nuclei, the motor nuclei. So these facial nuclei actually have two parts, the upper half and the lower half. So the upper half actually supplies the upper half of the face, and the lower half supplies the lower half of the face. So these halves are not actually very clear, and it can said that if you draw an imaginary line through the eyes, then the part above that is supplied by the upper facial nuclei, and the part below that is supplied by the lower facial nuclei. But in between, there is a lot of overlap also happening. So coming to the upper motor neuron control of the facial nuclei, so the upper half, as you can see, is receiving inputs from the contralateral hemisphere as well as from the ipsilateral hemisphere. However, the lower half is receiving inputs only from the contralateral hemisphere. So if there is a lesion here, then what will happen? So then the inputs coming to the upper part of the facial nuclei would still be preserved. Why? Because there is some supply from the ipsilateral side. So therefore, the functions observed by this branch, that is the functions of the frontalis, is going to be spared. However, the supply to the lower half of the facial nuclei is getting impaired, and there is no ipsilateral supply as a backup. So all its function are going to be hampered, and its function was to supply the lower half of the face. So what will the child's face look like? So if you ask this child to raise both the eyebrows and show his teeth, then he would still be able to raise both the eyebrows, but the face, lower face, would show paralysis, and the face would move towards the normal side, gets retracted towards the normal side. So with this understanding, let us go and see how you actually examine a motor nerve. So this video shows you the same.
Good morning.
So we actually, we don't directly jump into examination. The first thing is always inspection. So you would like to engage the child in some sort of a discussion, observe her face, or look for any asymmetry, look for any abnormality in folds of the forehead, eyelid position, width of the palpebral fissure, look at the nasolabial folds for symmetry, the angle of the mouth. So this is how the examination goes.
And what is your date of birth?
My date of birth is 12 November 2010.
Okay, Riddhi, I'll be testing the 7th cranial nerve in you and see if your facial expressions and facial movements are all fine. Is it okay with you?
Okay.
Okay, so let me have a look at your face. So you can just stay relaxed.
over with the inspection, you start with the maneuvers. So the maneuvers start from the cranial
end. Didi. Now you have to do certain things for me.
Okay.
The first thing would be to look at the ceiling.
So this is for testing the frontalis.
And can you frown for me as well?
So you look
as if you're very angry.
If there any asymmetry
harder
between the two sides.
Frown. Look
so
in front and frown.
You don't see any asymmetry and there are visible curves.
Okay. Now you have to close both your eyes, Riddhi, tightly.
Yes.
Don't let me open them.
So this is to check the
close
orbicularis oculi.
Tight. Very good.
So normally a person will not be able to open a tightly closed eyelid.
Now Riddhi, you have to blow your cheeks. Okay. Harder, harder.
So this is to look at the functions of the buccinator.
Good. Now show your teeth.
So now you observe the nasolabial folds. Any retraction of the angle of the mouth.
Are you liking this?
Which we don't see here.
Good. So, Riddhi, the last thing. Now you have to...
So, along with this, you have to engage the child and produce some spontaneous smile as well. So, this is why the examiner has asked here.
Good. So... Are you liking this exercise?
So this is a spontaneous smile which also is not showing any abnormality.
Now you have to...
So then you look at the cervical branches and test
like
of platysma. So if you can see, by everting the lower lip, the platysma can be
good
made prominent.
So the motor functions of the seventh nerve are all okay in you. Thank you.
So once you find any abnormality
in
the motor functions of the seventh nerve, then you proceed to the sensory examination. And sensory examination is examination of taste as far as seventh nerve is concerned. Generally, you don't test it if you don't find any findings in your motor examination, but you have to, or you should, once you are see that the motor functions are abnormal. So the paraphernalia that is required is just a glass of water to rinse the mouth in between the taste sensing and a taste applicator, which we can usually use a spatula or a clean earbud. So you first instruct the patient that the tongue has to be kept protruding throughout the test. And the child has to raise his finger or the hand to denote that the taste was perceived. And actually or practically, you just need to taste, check for a single taste, but this has to be done bilaterally. So let us see how it is
Riddhi,
actually done.
Now I'll be testing your sense of taste.
Okay.
Okay. So for this, you have to stick your tongue out and I'll make you taste something. The moment you feel that you have tasted it, then you do a thumbs up sign. Okay.
Okay.
Remember, you don't have to take your tongue inside. Okay. Now stick out your tongue. Good. Now you can take in. Rinse your mouth. Now I'll be tasting the other side of your tongue in a similar manner. Okay? So stick out your tongue again.
So this is how you do on the opposite side. And the examination conclusion is made whether or not the same taste sensations were present bilaterally.
Riddhi, now I'll be testing.
So with this information, let us see this child and try to identify the site of the lesion. So what do we see? We see that as soon as the child cries, the angle of the mouth deviates to the right. The nasolabial folds are prominent here, but it is completely abolished. The eyes are open and there is no frowning or no curls that are found as compared to this side. So what do we conclude? So we conclude that the child has got a lower motor neuron type of left seventh nerve palsy. Now look at this video or sorry, this picture. So this girl is able to close both the eyes. There is some frowning present, but once the child is made to show his her teeth, there is some asymmetry which is there. The angle of the mouth is actually moving towards the right. So what do we conclude here? We conclude that there is some weakness of the lower half of the face, and the forehead is relatively preserved. The eyes are to some extent getting affected. So there is a facial weakness of the left side, but it is of an human origin. So the site of the lesion is a right human. Sorry, the site of the lesion is a right upper motor neuron lesion. So when you have an upper motor neuron lesion, you have to look for additional few things. One is whether there is a discrepancy between a voluntary movement and an involuntary movement. So if you see that when you make a voluntary movement and there is more deviation compared to a spontaneous smile, then it shows that the human lesion is there. The first interpretation it gives that definitely there is a human lesion. Because in an element lesion, whatever may be the reason of eliciting that response, it is going to be abolished. But if it is a voluntary movement which is showing abnormality compared to a emotional movement, then possibly the lesion is somewhere in the motor strip and the superficial cortex is primarily getting affected, as it is shown in the lesion that is there depicted in the CT scan. Now, if you have an involuntary facial weakness much more than the voluntary facial weakness, then this suggests that probably it is not the motor strip, but the supplementary motor area and the subcortical structures which are engaged in emotion is somewhere getting affected. And in this case, again, it is a marker of a human lesion, but this human lesion is probably deep down in the subcortical structures. So with this information, let us try to quickly localize the lesion of the seventh nerve. So if it is a cortical or a subcortical lesion, then there is a contralateral lower facial weakness with all the sensations preserved, along with a contralateral hemiparesis and spasticity. If the lesion is in pons, then it is a element type of a lesion, and there is a ipsilateral facial weakness with preserved sensations with contralateral hemiparesis with an ipsilateral sixth nerve lesion, palsy as well, because you have seen that it is closely associated with the course of the seventh nerve within the pons. And if the lesion is at the CP angle, just at when the facial nerves leaves the brainstem, then you will get a facial weakness, low ipsilateral element type facial weakness, and the lacrimation, salivation and other senses are actually intact, because you have seen that all these fibers are actually separate by that time, and only in the internal auditory canal they are actually come together. So if you have a lesion there proximal to the geniculate ganglion, then there is a possibility that along with the motor weakness, you will have your lacrimation, salivation, taste all getting probably involved. So this is one way by which we can actually use these testing of these sensory modalities in localizing the lesion. Now, if the lesion is distal to the geniculate, so then the lacrimation fibers have already, the parasympathetic fibers has already left at the geniculate ganglion. So the lacrimation is going to be intact, but the salivation and taste would be impaired. And if the lesion is below, once the cauda tympani, that is the sensory nerve, has already left, so you will get a pure motor affection in the facial canal or around the stylomastoid foramen. So let us go to the next cranial nerve, which is eighth cranial nerve. So this eighth cranial nerve is primarily a sensory nerve and has got two major distributions, cochlear and the vestibular. So the cochlear deals with the hearing and tinnitus, and it originates from the organ of corti and the spiral ganglion around that. So from there, the auditory nerve or the cochlear division of the eighth cranial nerve arises. It moves into the internal auditory meatus and then enters the brainstem. Now at the brainstem, a part of it actually crosses to the opposite side and ascends, but a part of it also ascends ipsilaterally. So this ascending fibers form the lateral lemniscus, which actually end at the inferior colliculus, from where it relays to the medial geniculate body, and from there the finally relays to the superficial temporal lobe. Now, if because there is a bihemispheric presentation. So generally a human lesion is not going to cause a unilateral severe hearing loss. So how do we test the hearing of a child? So again, first we take a history whether the child has any problems in conversation, even listening to telephone or whispers,
hearing,
and then you
testing your hearing sense.
Proceed with masking of one ear and presenting a soft sound, which is in the form of rubbing of fingers, and see if the child is able to hear. You can also whisper at say 6 centimeters and 15 centimeters. You can say a number and ask the child to repeat so that you see that whatever you have said, the child has heard it appropriately. And this is how you basically screen both the sides and come to a conclusion whether the hearing is preserved or not. So the moment you feel that the hearing is affected, then you proceed with a more finer test, that is through usage of tuning fork. So we use a 512 hertz tuning fork and we do two tests, Rini test and the Weber test. So Rini, in Rini test, what we do is that we place a vibrating tuning fork over the mastoid, which is just for bone conduction,
and
see
it here
till the time the child is able to hear.
Feel any vibration or you don't hear anything, you let me know.
The moment child stops hearing it, then you present it in front of the tragus to see whether the child is still able to hear this. So normally what will happen is that the ear conduction is going to be better than bone conduction, and this is known as Rini positive. Now if you have a conductive deafness,
the same test
that means that the ear conduction is actually getting impaired, then the bone conduction would be more than the ear conduction, and this is known as Rini's negative. So what will happen in a sensorineural hearing loss? In a SNHL, both bone conduction and ear conduction are going to be dampened compared to the opposite ear. But still, they will maintain the relationship of ear conduction more than bone conduction. So still, it will be Rini's positive, but the response would be far less than the normal ear. So once you have tested the Rini test, you go to the Weber test, where you place the vibrating tuning fork on the midline, and you ask the child if he's able, she is able to hear it equally. So a normal child would hear it in both the ears, and if there is a conductive deafness, then the sound would get lateralized to the affected ear or the involved ear. And in a sensory neural loss, it will get lateralized to the normal ear. So in a non-cooperative or child or an infant, you can also do a basic test of an auditopalpebral reflex or a startle response, where you can produce a sudden unexpected loud sound and see the blink response or alertness in the kid. If you find any abnormality, then you should actually subject the kid for a proper electronic testing with pure tone audiometry and BERA. BERA would be an objective test, and this can look at the integrity of auditory pathway in a conscious as well as an unconscious child. The vestibular division is generally not tested, and the indication are only when there is a vertigo, dizziness, nystagmus present, or you want to assess the brainstem function in a critically ill child. So generally, there are two major reflexes which test. One is the vestibulo-ocular reflex, which is the doll's eye, generally used tested in critically ill, and the other is the vestibulospinal reflex. So what we do is that we look for positional nystagmus and vertigo, which are the primary features of vestibular affection. So what we do here is that we do a test which is known as
a test. Okay, in which I'll make you
suddenly
draw back
the child from a sitting to a supine position,
a dizzy,
with the head tilted at 45 degrees.
I'm there to
so that one ear becomes in the as a dependent
like
ear.
This. Okay.
The moment you do this, you look at the face for any visible nystagmus, and it may take 20 to 30 seconds for the nystagmus to appear.
Do you feel any dizziness?
You have to actually wait for 1 minute, and then you
bring
the child back to the sitting position, and again you look for any nystagmus. At the same time, you can ask the kid if he or she felt any vertiginous sensation. Along with this, you can do a
breathing
Romberg's test.
Now I want to
which
see
is not your
how you
only
balance
a vestibular function
and
test
your position.
Because it requires
okay.
also
so just
intact dorsal column.
Stand in a
how
rest
do we do that? We ask the child to stand in
stand
a
at ease.
Rest.
Keep your
feet approximated
together.
And then we ask them the kid to close their eyes.
Now
and
close your
any deviation.
Close your
or shifts his feet to stabilize herself, then we call the Romberg sign is present.
Okay, good.
Else
you
can
great balance. Now
ready.
You have to touch my fingers. Okay, now you have to close your eyes, move your hands overhead and come down and touch my fingers again. Do this.
The child is asked to close his eyes and then bring her fingers back and touch the examiner to see if there is any deviation happening. The side which is getting deviated would be abnormal. The cold caloric test is another test which we do, and it can be done in a conscious child as well as an unconscious children. It's reliable after 6 to 8 months of age. But here we first forewarn the child that they can be dizziness and vomitings, and then make the child sit in a sitting on a reclining position. You inspect for any tympanic membrane form, perforation or any infection or otitis media. Then you instruct the child to gaze straight ahead and irrigate the ear with 50 ml of cold, which is 30 degrees Celsius, or warm 44 degrees Celsius of water. And you irrigate it over a period of say 40 seconds. So after this, then you look at both the ears and see whether or not there is any nystagmus that has appeared in the ear with, nystagmus that has appeared after you have instilled cold and then warm water. So the normal mnemonic or the general mnemonic that you can remember is cows, that says that cold leads to opposite and warm leads to same. So it means that if you instill cold water irrigation, then the first component of the nystagmus would be towards the opposite side of the irrigated ear. And if you irrigate with warm water, then the first component would be onto the same side of the irrigated ear. So coming on to the next set of nerves, which are 9 and 10. So these nerves actually have a lot of functions which they perform together. And it is difficult to actually test them individually. So we actually deal with them together. So this 9th cranial nerve again originates from the medulla and comes out through the jugular foramina and is carrying parasympathetic motor and sensory fibers. The parasympathetic supply goes to the parotid gland. The motor supply goes to the only muscle that it supplies, that is the stylopharyngeus. And the general and special sensory goes to the tongue, tonsils, and then the and the chemoreceptors. So it is carrying taste to the posterior one-third of the tongue. The 10th cranial nerve is a very extensive and large nerve which is supplying to the head, neck, thorax, abdomen. It again originates at the medulla and then moves out through the internal jugular foramen along with the 9th and the 11th cranial nerve. Now the because it's a mixed nerve, it has got supplies parasympathetic, motor and sensory coming from the various nuclei that I have already told you that the sensations come from the tractus solitarius nuclei, the general somatic sensations come from the trigeminal nuclei, and the motor comes from the nucleus ambiguous and the dorsal vagus nuclei. The dorsal vagus nucleus gives motor supply to the smooth muscles, and the nucleus ambiguous gives fibers to the motor supply of the constrictors of the pharynx, larynx, and the palatal muscles. So both these two nerves have an important function of swallowing and speech. So the palate is supplied by 10th nerve along with the 5th cranial nerve, the pharynx along with the 9th cranial nerve, and the larynx is supplied unaided solely primarily by the 10th cranial nerve itself. So the two functions that they subserve is swallowing and speech, which we actually test. So there are certain core concepts that we need to understand about swallowing. Now, if you swallow some water, then you will notice that it is a coordinated activity of bulbar and respiratory muscles both. And one important muscle plays a very important part, which is the levator belli palatini, supplied by the pharyngeal plexus. Now, this muscle actually moves the soft palate, which is in red, and pulls it down and up, so that at certain times or in certain actions, this can act form a seal between the nasopharynx and the oropharynx. So this seal formation is required for a variety of work. The most important activity for which you have to have a proper seal is your swallowing. The other is when you want to whistle. And then you would also want to have as a proper seal when you are making certain speech sounds. So if the seal is not happening appropriately, or there is some sort of an insufficiency of this muscle or the soft palate, then what will happen? During the swallowing, there would be nasal regurgitation of food. Once you are talking, there would be a nasal twang to your voice. So this change in speech, there are two things that to be understood. So one is that this act can either lead to a hyponasal or a hypernasal speech. So what I mean by hyponasal is that sometimes if you close your nostril and you say something, then you notice that the sound character actually changes. So hyponasal speech is when there's too little air escapes from the nose, which will happen when there is an obstruction, as you have this when you have an URI. And hypernasal speech happens when there's too much of air escapes, which will happen when this seal between the nasopharynx and oropharynx is not happening, either because of a mechanical defect or because of a weakness. So understanding whether it is a hyponasal or hypernasal speech is important in pediatric age group. Now, one important reason why I'm saying this is that frequently this age group has got adenoids. So what will actually happen if you have a hypertrophied adenoid? So a hypertrophied adenoid will decrease the posterior pharyngeal wall space. So it will lead to an obstruction. So it will cause a hyponasal speech. Now imagine a child with a neurogenic palatal weakness because of a muscular dystrophy or because of a cranial nerve palsy. And the examiner detects there is a large adenoid. So many a times it is falsely alleged as a reason for this change in voice and it gets removed. So what happens is that if you remove an adenoid in this child, then the gate would be wide and the weak soft palate will not be able to close. So what will happen? So the hypernasal speech will actually worsen. So therefore, in these kids, removal of adenoid is actually worsening the scenario, worsening the presentation of the child. So other important thing that we need to understand about speech is that it requires two important activity of larynx and oropharynx. One is phonation and the other is articulation. So phonation is the sound production through the vocal cord vibration. So if the vocal cord is paralyzed, which happens in tenor of palsy, then you will have dysphonia. The second thing is that this sound has to be shaped into a speech, which is articulation and is done by the lips, tongue and palate. So if you see, they will have labials, such as if you say pa, 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 mi, 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 you will notice that the lips are actually moving a lot. They are linguals, and similarly, there are certain words which require the palate to move. So this all gets affected. So let us see how we actually examine the 9th and 10th cranial nerve in a child. So again, we take a history of regurgitation or a nasal twang, choking, dysphonia, dysarthria, or dysphagia.
So can you sing a nursery
rhyme? So we can ask the child
to sing
a nursery rhyme and see if the tone is, and there's the phonation and articulation is all normal.
Machli jal ki rani hai.
So because the time is short, I'll be slightly running through the video.
So let us go to the... Okay. So now can you repeat?
Testing of the order KLM testing. Now this
la, 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 la,
is actually testing the palatal movement.
Me, 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 me.
Is testing the lips.
Can you do a loud cough?
Sorry, the tongue. And me is testing the lips. Then
not
you
ready.
Ask the child to take a cough so that
water?
You see that the cough reflex is okay. And then you can ask the child to swallow some water and see if the swallowing is posing any abnormality or you see any nasal regurgitation.
So you had any problem?
So once you have done this, then...
Okay. Now, Didi, you have to say...
Part of your examination is...
Keep your mouth wide.
So then you would actually look at the palatal movement.
Now I want to...
So you ask the child to say... And you see the movement of the tonsillar pillars. So you see that both the tonsillar pillars are actually very silent. Now you have to understand that you don't have to just look at the uvula because sometimes it can be asymmetrically present. So the key findings of asymmetric paralysis of the palate is to look at the tonsillar pillars and see if there is any asymmetrical elevation when the child is saying ah. The side which is paralyzed will fail to elevate. Apart from this, then you can go ahead and test the gag reflex. But mind you, it is a very uncomfortable test. So what we recommend is that you don't do a gag reflex unless and until the previous history and test have given evidences of dysarthria and dysphagia. If there is no such evidence, then maybe you can omit a gag reflex. In case you have to do that, then you actually touch the palate or tonsil with a spatula and the response to it would be a sudden contraction of the pharynx, elevation of the palate and retraction of the tongue. So, so if it is very brisk, then you can say that it is an hyperactive gag reflex, which is a marker of an Eumann lesion. Now, if there is an element lesion or paralysis of 9th or 10th cranial nerve, then the gag may be absent. But mind you, a subset of patients will actually have an absent, a normal patients will have, can have an absent gag reflex. So this information should be there in your mind. Now going to the 11th cranial nerve. So this 11th cranial nerve is actually a motor nerve and has got two parts, the spinal part and the accessory part. Now the accessory part arises from the nucleus ambiguus and merges with the vagus, so we are not able to actually test it. What we test is the spinal part. This spinal part originates from the ventral horns from C1 to C5. They move up through the foramen magnum and then come out through the internal jugular foramen. And then it gives its motor supply to two major muscles, the sternocleidomastoid and the trapezius. Now, what is the function of sternocleidomastoid? Now, the sternocleidomastoid has got three important functions. If there is bilateral movement, bilateral contraction of sternocleidomastoid, then it will thrust the head forward. If there is a unilateral movement, then it will turn the head to the opposite side and tilt the head to the same side. Trapezius is involved in shrugging movement of the shoulder and abduction of arm above the 90 degrees. Now this 11th cranial nerve innervates the rostral part of trapezius, which is involved in lifting the shoulder. The rest of the trapezius muscle actually gets supplied through the cervical plexus. So let us see how you examine this. So again, you inspect and see the contour of the neck.
I agree.
If you are looking for
now I will be testing you.
And if you are
looking at the sternocleidomastoid, final part of the 11th cranial nerve.
Is any
now for this then
tilt that is there?
I will be testing one of your muscles, which is known as sternocleidomastoid. It is somewhere here. Okay. So Riddhi, now you have to press against my forehead.
So this
good.
Will test both the functions, the contraction of both the sternocleidomastoid.
Relax.
Then you test
now, Didi,
each sternocleidomastoid one by one.
Against my fingers with your cheeks. Press, press.
So the
good.
Right sternocleidomastoid will turn towards the left and see it is becoming prominent.
Okay, relax. Now you have
and
to
you
do
compare
the same thing
strength
on the
opposite
side.
Spine. So remember that your hand should be on the cheeks and not on the mandibles. Because if you push the mandibles, then the lateral pterygoid muscle will also come into action.
Shoulder.
And you would be testing both the muscles, which is not right.
Let me have a look at
you should always keep your hand on the cheek and rather than on the mandible. Then you move for trapezius, you look at the shoulder contours, see if there is any asymmetry, any drooping of the shoulder. And then you ask the child to shrug.
Now, Riddhi, you again shrug your shoulder and I
ask the child to shrug against resistance and see if you are able to block it. In this way, you test for these two muscles. Now, there is a question for you guys. So, if your child has got a left capsular infarct, his face would look towards which side? Towards the lesion or away from the lesion? So, if we go by the general understanding, then this left capsular infarct will lead to a right hemiparesis. So, right hemiparesis would mean that the right side is affected and therefore the right sternocleidomastoid mastoid is getting affected. The right weak right sternocleidomastoid mastoid will actually be moving the head towards the left. But because the right sternocleidomastoid mastoid is weak, this action will not happen and the opposite unaffected side will have an unopposed action and the head would move towards the right side. So, the answer should be what? So the answer would be that the head is moving away from the lesion. That is, it is moving towards the right because of unopposed action of the left. So, but this is actually wrong. So why it is wrong is because that this sternocleidomastoid, the fibers of 11th nerve reaching the sternocleidomastoid, these are actually ipsilateral in nature, or they are actually double decussate and reach the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So, if you have a left-sided stroke, you will have a left-sided sternocleidomastoid weakness. And the left-side sternocleidomastoid weakness will not be able to move the side towards the opposite side. And the unopposed action of the left side would move the head or the face towards the side of the lesion. So, the answer would be that the face would move towards the side of the lesion because the sternocleidomastoid on the ipsilateral side is getting weak and it is not able to move the head towards the opposite side. And the unopposed action of the normal sternocleidomastoid or the opposite side has moved the head towards the side of the lesion. So this ipsilateral supply to the sternocleidomastoid also can also be seen if you have seen any child with a right focal seizure originating from the left frontal region. So if you have a right-sided seizure, where does the head go? The head goes towards the right side only. So a right side head movement is because of what? Because of the involvement of the left sternocleidomastoid. So again, this shows that there is an ipsilateral supply to the sternocleidomastoid. However, the same doesn't hold true for trapezius and it receives the usual contralateral innervation. Coming to the last cranial nerve, which is the hypoglossal nerve, as it runs beneath the tongue. So this again originates from the medulla. It is primarily a motor nerve and supplies the muscles of the tongue except for palatoglossus. So one major muscle that it supplies is genioglossal and its function we have to understand. Now, the genioglossus is in a fan-shaped manner and if the right-sided fibers of genioglossus contract, it will protrude the tongue, but the tip of the tongue would move towards the opposite side. So, contraction of a right genioglossus would lead to deviation of the tongue towards the left in a normal scenario. So, let us test the 12th cranial.
Really?
So again, we will first inspect the tongue while it is at rest within the mouth. Look for size, shape and position, any atrophy, any abnormal movement like fasciculations present. Then at times you can palpate the thumb wearing a rubber glove between the thumb and index finger. But many times it is not required.
Up and down.
The movements in all directions are appropriate and you see that the tongue strength is normal.
Now, Riddhi, this tongue strength can be tested through this test. Let me see how much power
It has. Asking to move the tip of the tongue against the examiner's finger.
The side.
And the cheek.
Good.
So you.
Thank you.
Do it both the sides and compare the strength of the tongue. So if you find it all normal, then you can conclude that the hypoglossal nerve is all intact. So here, we need to understand that because the genioglossus movement was actually leading the deviation of tongue towards the opposite side, so if there is a unilateral lesion, human or element, then the tip of the tongue would actually deviate towards the paralyzed side because of unopposed action of the opposite side of genioglossus. Now, but this actually happens only when the tongue is protruded, because genioglossal is an extrinsic muscle and it acts when the tongue is protruded. Once the tongue is within the mouth, then it is difficult to move it on the paralyzed side, while it can be easily deviated on the non-paralyzed side. So because this happens because of the involvement or action of the small lateral movement, intrinsic muscles of the tongue, which involved in the lateral movement when the tongue is within the mouth. So in a child with a right hemispheric lesion, the tongue would deviate towards the left, which will be the side which is paralyzed. So with this, we conclude all the 12 cranial nerves. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Prasanth, for that exhaustive description of the last 6 cranial nerves with cartoons and videos that were very illustrative. We had more than 200 participants. And I'm just going to ask you the questions that have come up so far. First of all, a question of my own, Prashant, is there any scope for any condition that you actually need to palpate any of the nerves? For example, the seventh nerve is something that sometimes you can palpate. Is there any scope in the examination of the seventh nerve in a condition where you need to palpate the nerve?
Routinely, generally, you don't need it, but sometimes maybe in children or in patients who have, say, leprosy or something, and there is a specific involvement of these nerves, then maybe palpation of nerves can be meaningful. But then you have to be experienced enough to actually palpate that.
Right. And the commonest pathology in pediatric practice relating to the seventh nerve is the Bell's palsy.
Sure.
And the commonest sort of etiology we think about is related to the ear infections. So if you do get a lower motor neuron seventh palsy, apart from thinking about Bell's palsy related to ear, do we need to keep anything in our mind as a differential, or can we, as a, let's say in the MD level, be happy to say this is Bell's palsy, most likely? Of course, we are going to take the history and do the other examination of the ear, but will that be sufficient, you think?
So see, actually Bell's palsy is, truly speaking, an idiopathic affection of the facial nerve, which is of a lower motor neuron type. So you need to be actually looking at any trauma or any congenital malformation of the facial canal which could have led to an obstruction. And there could be certain congenital syndromes which will have combined 6th and 7th cranial nerves. So then if someone has come up and they are not very sure about the onset, you should ask for any previous photographs. If they are all normal, then you should conclude that okay, I am dealing with an acute onset 7th nerve palsy. If that is the case, then these possibilities would become less likely, but still trauma would be something which I would want everyone to notice. And then maybe at times you can have some slow growing mass occurring at the CP angle. So that is one other reason why a child can have purely some cranial nerve affection. And the other cranial nerve affections take a lot of time because there is a subarachnoid space where there is enough space for everyone, for every all other nerves. And it takes a lot of time for the mass to grow and show an affection. So if you have any doubt, or if you have a lot of pain occurring in the ears, so then obviously herpes zoster has to be ruled out, which is in itself a cause of, nowadays we consider it as a cause of Bell's palsy. So these are the set of things that probably everyone has to understand and try to rule out. Now the examination would help you to establish that yes, you are dealing with a lower motor neuron type of infection. And when it is a Bell's palsy, it is majorly a viral infection triggered thing. So it is not a specific part which gets affected. So a multi-site affection happens most of the time, which is primarily somewhere below, distal to the geniculate ganglia or in the facial canal above the stylomastoid foramen. So that is the area which gets affected. So I hope I try to answer your question.
Another question about the seventh nerve that has come up from the audience is how to differentiate between bilateral upper motor neuron facial palsy from bilateral lower motor neuron palsy. You're talking about bilateral affection and trying to differentiate between the two sides.
So see, when are you going to suspect a bilateral? So there can be certain hypothetical situations. Truly speaking, what will happen? A bilateral seventh nerve palsy would happen when there is a affection which is happening in the pons, you know, because post pons there is no place where you can actually have both the facial nerves getting engaged. So if you have an affectionate pons, what will happen? So pons is a place where there are other cranial nerves also. So you will have a lot of cranial nerve affection along with them. Secondly, you will have engagement or impairedness of your taste sensations. So these sensations are actually not getting relayed at the motor cortex. So they are actually getting to the thalamus and then they get relayed to the somewhere in the parietal and the temporal regions. So by testing this, you will be able to still make out that are you dealing with a bilateral lower motor neuron type of affection or a bilateral upper motor neuron type of affection, which is again going to be quite less likely. You will have to, it will be really very rare. But still, if you are looking at taste or the sensory affection, your lacrimation, the parasympathetic affection, they are going to be preserved if there is a lesion above the pons. But they would be affected in a lesion below the pons. So by testing that, maybe we'll be able to differentiate between the two.
Okay, so somebody is asked to kindly repeat the side of lesion and which side of nerve affected in seventh. I think for that you might have to go back to your diagram. So we'll do that at the end if we have time.
Sure.
Another question is, it's just a statement. I mean, it's probably asking what is the difference between bulbar versus pseudo-bulbar palsy.
Okay.
I think it's written bulbar versus pseudobulbar. I think it's a statement. How can you differentiate or what
is the examination? I truly understand. So this is one important thing that should have been there in the talk, but because of the lack of time, it was not appropriately covered. So see, what do we mean by bulb? So bulb is the medulla. So when you have a bulbar palsy, we are actually talking about the lower motor neuron palsy of 9th and 10th cranial nerves. So if you have a lower motor neuron type of palsy of 9 and 10 cranial nerves, the features would be as you get in your paralysis of your 9 and 10th cranial nerve, which would be an absent gag, which would be difficulty in swallowing. And if you have a pseudobulbar palsy, pseudobulbar palsy is an UMN palsy. That means that the supranuclear control to the bulb is getting lost. So what happens that the corticobulbar tract is getting affected in a pseudobulbar palsy, and this tract is also engaged in your emotions and facial expressions. So what will happen that the pseudobulbar palsy, you will have inappropriate emotional outbursts, inappropriate laughters happening. And along with that, you will have signs of human affection, which will be a hyperplastic gag, which will be a brisk jaw jerk, and there would be a spastic small tongue. So these features would tell you that you are probably dealing with a pseudo-verbal palsy. Now, because there is always a bilateral innervation, it is not unihemispheric innervation in cranial nerves, so a single hemispheric lesion is not going to cause you a pseudo-bulbar palsy. It has to be a both the cortex getting affected. So generally, it is not a stroke which will lead to a pseudo-bulbar palsy. It will be there in progressive disorders like multiple sclerosis, like cerebral palsy for us. So if you have that setup in which you have other UMN signs, you have emotional outbursts, you have a brisk jaw jerk, you have a brisk gag reflex, and along with that, you have a spastic tongue, which you are finding it difficult to do all those lateral sidewards movement, and the speech is also spastic, then you conclude that you are dealing with a pseudo-bulbar palsy. And for bulbar palsy, whatever I have discussed in the 9th and 10th cranial nerve are going to be the clinical features.
Right. Okay. The sensory supply of facial is actually through trigeminal nerve. So do we mention it in facial nerve examination? Or
no, sir. So this is... So in the facial nuclei, while I was discussing that, I brought two important things, that these nuclei are not exclusive to any single nerve. So there is a big trigeminal sensory system which runs from the mesenchymal up to the spine, upper spine. So all the somatic sensation, that is pain, touch, temperature, through wherever in the face and neck and through whichever nerve is actually ends at the trigeminal nucleus. So therefore, we have a notion that it is the trigeminal nerve which is supplying that. No, the trigeminal nuclei is supplying that, and the fiber runs in the facial nerve. So, and the same is true for your gustatory sensation. So gustatory sensation of the 7th nerve, gustatory sensation of the 9th nerve, gustatory sensation of the 10th nerve, all of them are starting at the nucleus tractus solitarius, but they are all different nerves. So this concept has to be there.
Right. Okay. Interpretation of the Rini test in case of unilateral hearing loss and why?
Okay. So Rini test is testing what? So there are sometimes residents get confused with Rini positive and Rini negative. So what happens? What are we doing in Rini test? We are actually testing the bone conduction and the air conduction in one side. So what routinely happens that your air conduction is better than the bone conduction. Air conduction is meaning that there is the conduction that is happening towards the external auditory meatus and then the vibration at the eardrum. The bone conduction is actually can be considered as a marker of your nervous system supply. So if you do a Rini test and you find that after you have the sound at the postmastoid has ended, still you are able to hear from in front of your tragus, that means that your air conduction is better than the bone conduction. So this is known as Rini's positive. Now this Rini's positive can happen in two conditions. Either you have a normal hearing or you have a sensory neural hearing loss. So therefore, all of us need to understand that tuning fork tests are not to establish hearing loss. If you have established that there is some kind of a hearing loss or you have suspected a hearing loss, then these can be used to actually distinguish between conductive and sensory neural. So if you have already, you are not sure that the child has got a hearing loss or not, then a positive Rini's would suggest that the child has got a normal hearing. Now, if you have a unilateral sensory neural hearing loss, then what will happen? Because the nerve supply is impaired, both the bone conduction and the air conduction of that side is going to be dampened compared to the opposite side. However, the relationship stays the same. That is, air conduction is going to last longer than the bone conduction. but both would be actually of a shorter duration. So again, this would be Rini's positive. But once you compare with the opposite ear, then you would know that the duration for which it is happening is quite less. So therefore, this is how you conclude the and or you make interpretations of the Rini test.
Okay, thank you. So the last question is what are the causes for velopharyngeal incompetence? Okay. And if we can answer that and then perhaps go back to the seventh nerve query that might be better explained by the diagram.
Okay.
Causes for velopharyngeal incompetence.
So velo is what? Velo is the word used for soft palate. So velopharyngeal incompetence is the weakness of the soft palate and the related muscles. So this will happen when? This will happen, as I already told you, by the affection of the nerve supply of this region. And what is that? That is vagus. Or at times it is the pharyngeal plexus, which is again found by the vagus with the 11th cranial nerve. Sorry, the 9th cranial nerve. So whenever there is a weakness or there is a neuropathy, then you can have this palatal or velopalatal insufficiency. Along with this, you can have this once there is a mechanical defect. There is a cleft palate that is present. So again, it will not be able to form an appropriate C. So again, it will be a deficient. The third scenario is a muscular dystrophy, where you have some predilection for affection of these small muscles of pharynx and larynx, and you have difficulty in your swallowing. So that is a third scenario where you will have a velopharyngeal insufficiency.
Right. So if you can go back to the question.
I'll do that.
Kindly repeat the side of lesion for the nerve affected in 7th and, if possible, the 12th. These two nerves repeat the sort of diagram.
Okay.
And that will be all. After that, we can stop.
So this was the slide that showed what is the localizing value of the various signs that you see in the 7th nerve. So I would try to make this table even simpler. So you can identify a few anatomical points. The first anatomical point is a human problem. So human problem can be cortex or subcortex. Then you identify the nuclei. The site of the nuclei is pons. And then the third site can be identified as a geniculate body or the geniculate ganglion. And the fourth site as the stylomastoid foramina. So if you imagine these four anatomical points, then it will be far more easy for you to understand. Now, once you have a human lesion, then what the palsy would be a central facial palsy, which will be sparing of the upper fibers and affection of the lower facial. So this would be a contralateral affection. So once there is a cortical affection, there would be a contralateral hemiparesis and a contralateral 7th nerve palsy. So that would mean that there is an uncrossed hemiplegia. And the cause of it is generally an infarction. And there would be, along with that, because the pyramidal tract is also getting affected, so you will have spasticity. So once the nuclei is getting affected, so then it is an element palsy happening. So what will happen here is that you will have contralateral hemiparesis, but you will have ipsilateral facial weakness, which will be of the lower motor neuron type. So this is known as a crossed hemiplegia. And this is again commonly because of pontine glioma, infarct or demyelination. But in the pons, as you have already seen that the nucleus are widespread, so maybe the superior salivary nucleus or the nucleus tractus solitarius is not getting affected, and therefore you generally don't see lacrimation, salivation or taste getting affected here. So a pontine lesion will lead to ipsilateral element facial palsy with contralateral hemiplegia, and because of its close association with 6th nerve, you will always commonly find a 6th nerve weakness as well. So once this moves out and reaches the geniculate ganglion, so it emerges out through the cerebellopontine angle and enters the internal auditory canal. So if there is any lesion that is happening here, so what will happen? So again, there would be a element facial weakness, but here before the geniculate nuclei, the fibers have not left. The sensory and the parasympathetic fibers are all there, and they have come in close approximation in the internal auditory canal. So if you have a lesion here, you will have a likely affection of your taste, salivation, lacrimation, along with the facial nerve palsy. And internal auditory canal, the seventh nerve is moving with which other cranial nerve? That is the eighth cranial nerve. So you will also have tinnitus and nystagmus along with that. Once you have crossed the geniculate ganglion and moved further, and there is a lesion beyond geniculate ganglia, so what will happen? At the geniculate ganglia, the parasympathetic fibers in the facial nerve or the nervous intermedius, which is the combination of the parasympathetic and sensory fibers, the parasympathetic fibers have left to supply the lacrimal gland. So the lacrimation would be spared, but taste and salivation will be affected. So if you go down, and if there is a lesion just before the facial canal where the chorda tympani has left, so once the chorda tympani is actually carrying the sensory fibers with us, so the again the sensory fibers would be spared. So here all the sensations would be spared and the parasympathetic functions would be spared. So lacrimation, salivation, taste would be spared here, and only a motor weakness would happen. The same would happen in the stylomastoid foramina. Now, if the lesion is outside the stylomastoid foramina, that means that the lesion is in the parotid gland. So you will get an obvious swelling and inflammation, pain, tenderness, which will again give you that the site of lesion is outside the stylomastoid foramina. Or if it is inside the stylomastoid foramina, then you will not get all these findings, and just the motor weakness associated with element facial nerve palsy would be there. So probably this answers your question.
Yeah, I think that was very nicely explained. I think we have run out of time. So I'd like to thank Dr. Prashant for a very nicely done presentation with the aid of videos and cartoons on the lower six cranial nerves. I'd like to thank AOCN for taking the initiative about these PG webinars that have been specially formulated, and we are in the second series. So with that, I would like to end on the note that some of the attendees are asking, can we have recorded videos for these sessions, please? And I'm sure AOCN is going to look into that to see whether it can be put on the website. And a lot of attendees saying that Prashant's presentation was excellent, and thank you very much for your presentation. So with that, I'd like to conclude today's session. Thank you all the attendees, and thank you, Prashant.
Thank you, sir. And thank you, ASEAN, for this opportunity.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Good night, everyone.